In the Apostle Paul's first letter to the church that was meeting in the city of Corinth, he wrote, "Now you are the body of Christ, and individually you are members of this body." Those words were not simply extended to one community in one specific time, but to all who follow Jesus, that we are the body of Christ, and individually we are members of this body. Let us begin our time of worship.
Will you join me in our call to worship? The people of God have risen.
The one who gives life is the one who was, is, and shall be.
Let us look to God who continues to bring life out of death. Let us worship the one who reigns on high, yet is present to us always. Please stand as we sing our opening hymn. God, we come together to be reminded of your greatness and glory, your sovereign power and eternal purpose expressed so wonderfully in Jesus Christ, the risen one. Today, we thank you for the wonder of the ascension, that marvelous yet mysterious moment in the life of the apostles as they were left gazing heavenwards in confusion. Thank you, Lord, for the way you brought the earthly ministry of Jesus to conclusion, with the image of his presence reigning with you always. And this morning, Allow our spirits to ascend heavenward with inspiration and hope, for we desire to be your living body here on earth. Amen. Church, and happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. I am so glad that you are here today to worship with us. It is a beautiful day to be in this church together as one body. Inside your bulletins, you will find a blue card for your attendance, but also for your prayers and your concerns. We want to be in prayer with you over what matters most in your life, so be sure and fill these out for us. And now, as we do each and every week, let's reach out and greet one another, especially those that you don't know.
Good morning, church. It is good to be with you. Those words often slip across the lips pretty easily. But let me say, it is good to be with you for this time of worship. And I appreciate your flexibility this morning as we had a children's performance over in the other building, and it took a little while for people to filter over here for the beginning of this service. I do want to echo the words that Paula offered earlier in regard to it being Mother's Day. And I do want to first point out that in your worship guides this morning, you hopefully had a bookmark, just a little token of this day, but one for everybody. And so for those of you that maybe that's not really for you, the hope is maybe you'll consider passing it on to somebody. Maybe you'll be at lunch today and you'll find out your server is a mother, and it'll be an opportunity to gift her with that bookmark. But today I also want to just recognize the broad range of what we are talking about. Those who are mother biologically, those that have come into that role through adoption or choosing to be a foster parent. But I also want to lift up those women who have chosen to step in the gap in the life of someone who either did not have a mother or maybe did not have a healthy mother figure, and yet they have chosen to step into that void and to be that loving presence. And so for those gifts that you offer, thank you. I also want to extend gratitude to this congregation for what started this past week and will continue for a number of weeks. We are playing host to FEMA. Many families coming into our place to sit down with FEMA to find out how best to respond to their life situation. And not only did we open up our space, but we've provided a wonderful hospitality area with drinks and granola bars and other snacks, and remembering that a lot of these are families that are coming in. And I'm sure many of you can remember taking a young child into some session where you're gonna have to move from one table to another, and they're gonna have to sit quietly while you fill out paperwork. It is easier to do it if the child has a drink box and a granola bar in hand. So thank you, those of you that have been supportive in that ministry. Well, today is Ascension Sunday. It is the Sunday after the 40 days of Jesus being the resurrected Christ in the world, preparing to return to God. And so we turn to the book of Acts, the first chapter, verses 9 through 11. I invite you now to hear these words. After Jesus said these things, as the disciples were watching, Jesus was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going away, and as the disciples were staring toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood next to them. They said, "Galileans, why are you standing here looking toward heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way that you saw him go into heaven." With the gift of grace, the words of Scripture have already been blessed. So may we this day simply make ourselves available to those blessings that the Scripture has to offer. Will you join me in prayer? With hearts and spirits raised unto you, O Lord, may we be attentive to what the Scriptures invite us to see in this moment. May our lives be attentive to that calling that you put forth. Amen. In the fantasy adventure movie Terminator, Arnold Schwarzenegger's character says, "I'll be back." In the classic horror movie, Poltergeist 2, the young lady, Carol Ann, says, "They're back." And in the sci-fi movie, Independence Day, Randy Quaid's character says, "Hello, boys, I'm back." Sometimes it is a promise. Sometimes it is a warning. And other times it is a declaration. Now I must confess this morning that as I was driving up on Cypress Wood Drive toward the church and saw our church's sign with my sermon title on it, I had to laugh. The sermon title read, "I'm Back, Reverend Bruce Froge." People have been asking me all morning, "Where did you go?" I didn't go anywhere. I was simply recognizing that it is Ascension Sunday. And on this day, we are reminded of the divine messengers who appeared before the disciples as they were watching Jesus ascend up into heaven. And these divine messengers say to them that he will return in the same way or the same manner. Now the disciples have been staring up at the sky as if they are expecting him to immediately return. As if we're just talking like an elevator that went up and is soon going to be coming back down. But what is meant? What is meant by those words that the divine messengers offered, suggesting that Jesus was coming back? A friend of mine shared the following story in a sermon of hers, and I thought it was appropriate being Mother's Day. She tells of how she took her four kids on a cross-country road trip. And with her were not only her four kids, but her mother. And they were planning to just drive all night, switching off drivers to try to get the miles past them. But in the middle of the night, they needed to stop at a rest area. So they pulled in, thinking the four kids were asleep. Her mother went in to use the restroom while she got out of the car, but just stood there next to the car, stretching her legs. What she didn't realize was that her youngest, the six-year-old, the only boy, also got out of the car. Well, when her mother came back and got into the car, they pulled out and drove off. They were an hour down the road before they realized they were missing one of the children. This was before most folks had cell phones. And so in a panic, they turned the car around and made that hour drive back to the rest stop in 40 minutes. And as they pulled into the parking lot there at the rest stop, she could see her son standing next to a state trooper. She got out of the car, and the first words out of his mouth were, "I told you my mom would come back and get me. Even if my sisters didn't want her to come back, I knew that Grandma would vote yes." As she went on in her sermon reflecting on that experience, she said, "I always told my kids that if they got lost, they needed to find someone of authority, like a police officer, and to trust that she would come back for them." And she said, "My son did just that. He trusted my promise." I'm guessing some of you have seen the movie Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. In that movie, there is a scene where Indiana Jones, Dr. Jones, is in this vehicle, and suddenly it drives off a cliff and crashes and explodes in fire. It appears that he has met his demise. The three men that were following came as quickly as they could to the edge, and they look down and they see that vehicle burning, and they are overcome with grief, one of those men being Indiana Jones's father. What they didn't realize, no surprise, is At the very last minute, Indiana Jones had leaped from the vehicle before it went over the edge. But as they are grieving and their eyes are filled with tears, they do not see Indiana Jones standing with them. They do not recognize the one they thought was taken from them, actually standing right beside them. I believe many Christians are following the lead of the original disciples and staring toward the sky, waiting for Jesus to return. And they do not notice what is really being suggested in the passage. The divine messengers announce, "Why are you standing here, looking toward heaven? This Jesus who is taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way that you saw him go into heaven." The language "same way" or "same manner" does not suggest from the same direction. Back in 1990, I went to see the Indianapolis 500 time trials. And I had the opportunity to stand in the infield, which is an interesting perspective to have. When you're up in the grandstand, you can see quite a bit of the 2.5 mile track, but when you're in the infield, you can only see just a little portion of it. And so you would watch the car zip by, and then you would wait. But you don't continue to stare in the direction to which the car went, because soon that car is going to make it around that track and come from the other direction. If you want to see the car, you have to turn back and look in the opposite direction. The divine messengers speak about Jesus returning in the same way or the same manner, in the same way you saw him go into heaven. But it's important to note that the word that we translate as "go" into English, in the original Greek, is a passive verb. And so Jesus is not the one who is doing the going. Well, yes, he is going, but it was not by his own power. It was the power of God at work. The same power that raised him into heaven, the same power that raised him from the tomb, the same power that has brought him back is the same power that has raised up the body of Christ, that power being the Holy Spirit. In those words that I shared at the beginning of the service from 1 Corinthians, where the Apostle Paul says, "Now you are the body of Christ, and individually you are members of this body." What we learn there is the importance of us understanding what it means to be the body of Christ. Next week is Pentecost Sunday, when we will celebrate that Spirit coming and returning, that gift that will empower the community of faith to become the church or to become the body of Christ. And when we see the language of the body of Christ, it is not an honorary title. It is not a symbolic gesture. When the divine messengers say, "in the same manner," what is being described there is this same manner is by the Holy Spirit. The one who raised him will be the one whose very essence will return and indwell within us, removing everything that divides us, equipping us with gifts, inspiring our vision, and daring us to dream those gifts into reality, lifting us up to be the body of Christ in the here and now. My grandfather, for most of his adult life, worked for the railroad. And because he worked for the railroad, my grandparents traveled by train most of their lives. And I think it was because of that experience that my grandmother, no matter the circumstance, would often say, "Don't dilly-dally, or you're gonna miss the train." Well, I think a lot of folks are staring at the sky, dilly-dallying their lives away, and they are missing the train that we call the life of Jesus. Right here, right now, this us becoming the body of Christ for this moment of time. Not an honorary title, not just some nice gesture, we don't get just some badge. This is serious stuff for people of faith to understand that we are the body of Jesus Christ for the world in this moment. Not by our own doing, but by the gift of the Holy Spirit. A number of years ago, I became acquainted with a pastor. His name's Rhodes, a United Methodist pastor. And he was serving a church in Greenwich Village in New York City. His church members collectively believed themselves to be the body of Christ better than any community of faith I think I have ever seen. They would often say, so many people are looking toward the sky, but our ministry, they said, our ministry is to continue to announce, surprise, I'm here. This notion that they had was that they were to be the body of Christ, revealing the good news through their lives, drawing others into that experience so that they might join the larger body of Christ and thus bless even more people. As we are glancing heavenward on this Ascension Sunday, we need to hear again the words of those divine messengers who did not want us to end up with a stiff neck because we're only looking skyward. They wanted us to stop looking toward the heavens and instead look to the hearts of our neighbors, to stop looking towards the sky and instead look at the soul of our community, to stop loitering and lingering, but instead start living and loving in the way that Jesus has so beautifully demonstrated. We're not about waiting. We are about being the body of Christ to this world. And the good news for each of us is that we are doing it together. And so where my gifts fall short, your gifts can fill in. Where this side of the room falls short, this side of the room might be able to step in, and collectively, we are able to demonstrate to the world the good news of Jesus Christ, of a God who loves us without condition. We are the body of Christ. He's back, and not just in me, not just in you, but in us, for the world to see. I invite you now to open up your hymnals as we join our voices in hymn number 90, Come Christians, Join to Sing, a song of rejoicing, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit that binds us together to be the body of Christ. Through the power of the Spirit, God is present to us. And let us collect all of who we are and go before God in prayer. Let us not dwell upon what the future may hold, but on what you have done and continue to do in this moment. O giver of the Spirit, come and dwell. Inspire and lift up. make us once again into Christ's body here on earth. Kind and merciful God, we desire above all things to be the living presence of Jesus, to be that presence among our neighbors and within the larger community of Spring, Texas. We desire to do this because it is your calling for all those who claim to follow in the ways of Jesus. We are not to wait, but to act. Not to stare skyward, but to serve with our vision toward the least among us, towards the lost, the suffering, the brokenhearted, the marginalized, and the forgotten. Give us your mission, O Lord, not one that we do by simply staring heavenward and waiting, but a mission by which we can serve those around us, helping to embody your glorious good news that can transform hearts. This morning, as our hearts are united in prayer, we do turn to you, God, mindful of those who continue to struggle because of the damage caused by flooding and by wind. So many people remain rather confused and uncertain about their future. We know, Lord, that your Spirit is already present to them. But wherever we can be your body, wherever we can be your hands and feet, allow your Spirit to guide us and empower us and give us the words that are needed. And this morning, we lift up those within the life of our congregation who are in need of prayer, including Ken, Faye, Brenda, Donna, Lorraine, Twyla, JD, Bo, Sally, Isabel, Peggy, Joe, Ellie, Norma, Glenn, and Dawn. These names you know so very well, Lord, and we pray that not only your blessings abound, but that your Spirit will work through us so that we can be your instruments wherever we are called. We ask all of this now in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples and in turn taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It is often said that Jesus meets us at the table. And I believe this to be true, that Jesus, through the power of the Spirit, meets us at this table. But I also believe that Jesus meets us here through the body of Christ, through those that are sitting next to us, through the person who walks alongside us to receive the elements, those that are holding the elements on behalf of Christ. We are the body of Christ to one another. And in the faces, in the hands, in the expressions of kindness, we remind one another that we are not alone. Recognize how the living Christ meets you in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup.
Thank you.
This table was lovingly prepared for you, each and every one of you, for all are welcome to come to the Lord's table. When you come forward, you're invited to bring your attendance cards with your prayers and concerns, as well as your tithes and offerings, and place them in the baskets along the front. If you're unable to come forward, we invite you to raise your hand, and we'll come and serve you right where you are. We also have gluten-free for those that can't eat regular bread. When you come forward, we invite you to take a piece of that bread and dip it in the fruit juice and partake of that holy meal. Let us go to God in prayer.
O loving and gracious God, we gather at your table today, as we do each week, to share in this meal together, to partake of the symbols of Jesus' body and of his blood. This week, as we celebrate Ascension Sunday, help us to remember that this is not just a remembrance of Jesus, but a realization that his Spirit dwells with us each day. In your Son's name we pray, amen.
On that night before he was betrayed, Jesus sat at a table with his disciples, having an ordinary meal. In the course of the meal, he took the bread, he lifted it and blessed it, and then he broke it. And he said, "Take and eat from this, all of you, for this represents my body that will be broken for you." In a like manner, he took the cup, and he told them to drink from it, all of them, for this represents the blood of the new covenant, the forgiveness of sin. Again, all are welcome to come to the table. Come, let us partake of the holy meal.
Thank you. Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we praise you for all the many blessings you have given us. Bless these gifts received here today, that they will be used for the glory of God. Thank you for the power and glory of your Holy Spirit coming and dwelling among us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I believe sometimes Jesus has more confidence in us as the body of Christ than we do in ourselves. And that's where God continues to invite and encourage and allow the Spirit to empower. We need to remember that we are the body of Christ to the world right around us, to our neighbors. And though this service of worship is coming to an end, we need to continue in our service beyond these walls. Each Sunday, we extend an invitation not only to join this covenant community, but to join one's life with Christ. And if you wish to respond to that invitation, you can either come forward as we are singing, or you can meet with one of our elders or pastors out in the lobby after the service. Let us now join our voices. There's a lot going on always in the life of this congregation, and I tell you, just this past Saturday, with FEMA being here and so many other activities, it felt like chaos, and yet I love that. A church that is always open to the community, that is allowing these buildings that God has blessed us with to be unto service to our community. But some things I do want to lift up this morning. Next Saturday is our vacation Bible school preview. So on Saturday from 2 to 4, there's going to be a whole lot of stuff happening in the gym and outside. I think they even have a petting zoo coming up. So it'll be a great time. So we invite not only the children of our church, but if you have a neighbor or somebody you know, invite them to come up and be a part of all the activities. Vacation Bible school will be June 14th through the 17th. Next Sunday, as I referenced in the sermon, is Pentecost Sunday. And we want to remind you as has often been the case around here, to wear red. That is the color of Pentecost, the color of the flame that is associated with this wonderful season of the year. But we also want to lift up that there will be an outreach fair out here in the foyer between service and after service. Some of our outreach ministries will have a table, an opportunity for you to ask questions, or if there's a real interest, maybe to sign up to be supportive of that program. Coming up on May the 20th is Prime Timers, that wonderful group that gets together for lunch once a month on Friday. And our own Dan Wagner, I keep on saying his ukulele band. He just plays in the ukulele band. But there's going to be 18 of them that are going to come up and play. It should be a hoot. And if that's a time that you are available, sign up. Come and be a part of it. I'm planning on going, and I think it'll be a lot of fun. And again, some of you went over and heard our children singing between services. I was able to sneak in there and hear the first few minutes of it. It was great to see them and hear their sharing. Thanks to Joel for giving leadership to our children's music and this group as well. It is a marvelous gift. And if you were not here last Sunday evening, they put forth an amazing concert. It's always a special time in the life of our congregation. I now invite you to take the hand of somebody close and cast your eyes up to the screen where you will see our closing prayer. Gracious God, may your love and our lives come together in a life lived in love. May Jesus be our mentor and our model, and may the world see in us a life that is willing to put love first in all things. Amen.